Amen, Mr. Smith. Mr. Smith, make sure they're right. Turn with me, please, in your Bibles to the book of Ephesians. I want to review a few of the things we saw last week, and then from there move forward. Last week, I think we began in the book of Ephesians. I want to start there again. Ephesians chapter 6. We made some absolute statements of truth at the opening of our message last week. I want to review these absolute truths. The first truth is, and listen to it very carefully, of course, we're talking from this topic, having the greater power. Having the greater power. The first absolute truth we saw is this: power must be met with power. Power must be met with power. That's an absolute truth. That's why we use the word must. Power must be met with power. Power that is unchallenged will rule. Let me say that again. Power that is unchallenged will rule. Another absolute truth: power can only be stopped by a greater power. Let me make that statement again. And we use the word only because this is an absolute truth. Power can only be stopped by a greater power. Your Bible says Satan has power. That's an absolute truth, and your Bible says this many times over. Satan has power. The only way his power can be stopped is if it is confronted by a greater power. In order for Satan's power to be stopped, it must be challenged and it must be confronted. Hey! Satan don't go away simply because you ask him to. His power must be challenged and it must be confronted in order for it to be stopped. Can I get a louder amen than that? Amen. Satan has power over many people, even Christian people. Somebody says, tell the truth, I think I will. Satan has power over many Christians. Listen, but when we walk in power as Christians, all of Satan's power is broken off of us. A believer is only free from satanic power if that believer decides to walk in power themselves. Amen. Amen. And confront the power that's holding them in bondage.
and by a greater power overcome it. Can you all listen to me? Listen. Your Bible says, we have not the spirit of bondage again to fear. We don't fear bondage anymore because we have a greater power than the power that held us in bondage. Are y'all listening to me? If you fear going back to addictions, alcoholism, cocaine, lying, cussing, depression, perversion, it's because you're weak. Oh, but we don't fear bondage because we know we have a greater power. Somebody say amen. The Bible says all of our lifetime we were subject to bondage through fear. Well, thank God I'm not subject to any bondage. Some people really can't believe God and flow in God because they are afraid they can't succeed or continue. So why even start? When I have this fear, I'm going to fall and go back to my bondage. Well, thank God we don't have a fear of bondage anymore. Because we have a greater power. That's the good news. Amen. Listen to me carefully, please. A Christian without power will be overcome by the power of the devil and will be a defeated believer. You know, there are many defeated Christians because they're without power. And if you don't have any power, you will be, these are all absolutes, you will be overcome by the power of the devil. I don't care how many Bibles you have in your house. I don't care if you show up in church. Your life will be in bondage to devils if you don't know how to operate in power. These are just facts. Here's another one. Please listen. A church without power will be a defeated church. And there are many churches that are defeated churches because of a lack of power. Therefore, we must seek to always operate in power if we are going to be an overcoming, victorious church. What's the name of this church? Victorious Living Fellowship. Well, if we're going to be true to our name, we must be a church that seeks to operate in the power of God. Without the power of God, the label don't mean 2 cents worth of nothing. If it's going to be true, we must be a church of power. Amen. Now, please listen to Ephesians chapter 6 and verse 10. I'm sure you are there, and I'm sure you are ready to go. Amen? We saw this last week. We're just going to read a few things we saw last week and then move on. Notice it says, finally, my brethren, my born-again Christian people, finally, church people, be what? Hey, you can be a church person and be as weak as water and walk in defeat for the rest of your life. Why are we commanded to be strong? Be, brethren, strong in the Lord and in the power. Of whose might? Notice, that's a command to the church, to the brethren, be strong in the power of God. Is God ever defeated?
No.
Is God ever weak?
No.
Well, your Bible says he's strong and he's mighty. And your Bible says you and I
ought to be strong in his strength and be mighty in his power. Well, you see, God is never defeated because he's strong. God is never down because he walks in power. Well, your Bible says you and I can walk in the same power of God. Well, it goes beyond telling us we can. It tells us to do it. It's a command to the church because he wants an overcoming, victorious church. He wants overcoming, victorious believers, you see. And the only way to walk in victory, we have to be strong and people of power. The next verse tells us why. Well, verse 12. Look at verse 12. For why must we be strong? Because we, the church, wrestle. Well, that word wrestle means to contend with or to fight, you see. We saw this last week. We just mentioned, let me just do it again. You and I, we're in a fight. We're in a battle for our souls, for our victory, for our sanity, for our finances, for our health, for our families. Without power, we will lose family, sanity, wealth. How many Christians walk and live a decrepit, defeated life? Because they're without power. Family is crumbly. Health, crumbly. Sanity, gone. See, the world is on all kinds of antidepressant pills because the world is full of mental problems. You can't watch TV and not see a new drug to help your mind. All it is a devil. I don't know if you know this, but medication only suppresses it. It don't deliver you from it. You stop taking your pill, it's right back. Hey! We can deliver you in one day by the power of God. Notice, let me hurry up. For we wrestle not against flesh and blood. No, these are demons we got to fight. And how many of you know, ain't no sense in even engaging in a fight if you know you're weak. Hallelujah. You know what Paul said to Timothy? He said, be strong. Then he said, fight the good fight. Well, a good fight is a fight you win. I know some of you can't talk about the fight you had growing up because you're too ashamed. You got beat down. Nobody talks about that fight. But a good fight, hey, is the fight I walk away from with my chest out. That's a good one. Well, Paul told Timothy, fight the good fight. But before he told him that, he said, Timothy, be strong. Amen. If you're strong, you can win every battle. I said, if you're strong, you can win every battle. And in this life, you will fight battles. Devils come. It's not a fight with people, flesh and blood. These are demonic spirits. Be strong. He says, because you got to fight demons. Look at verse 12. For we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but we wrestle against principalities. Principalities. Against powers. Powers. Well, why must we be strong? Because our enemy has power. Well, you got to have greater power, because if you don't have greater power, the power of the enemy will overcome you. Notice he says, be strong in the power of God because your enemy got power. I said, notice he said, be strong in the power of God because you're in a fight person you're fighting against has power. But then notice there's an S on it. Powers, plural. Hey! He tell us have only one power. The power of God. Because the power of God can overcome all the powers of the devil. Now notice what he says. We have to fight against principalities, against powers, against the rulers. Notice they want to rule your life. How many of you know demon powers rule many people's lives? If you got addictions, if you got I can't help it, if you need pills just to get from day to day, something got a grip on your life. Powers, they rule you. They can't control your thoughts. Paul said, what I would do, I don't do. What I don't want to do, I do. He said, who shall deliver me? See, when you're like that, you need deliverance. I said you need deliverance. We wrestle against rulers of the darkness, the dark world. Rulers of the darkness of this world. Now, why do we have to fight them? Because they want to bring us back to darkness. They want to bring us back to the vices of this world. How many of you know this world is full of evil? Your Bible calls it this evil world. Well, notice, if you're not strong enough, these ruling spirits will pull you back into the dark things of this world. How many people you know got saved, and then in 2 or 3 months, they right back to smoking pot? See, a ruling spirit didn't want to let them go. And they didn't have power in their life as a believer to overcome that ruling spirit of addiction. Once you get free from it, you're going to have to learn to fight it. Here's why. Jesus says when the devil is cast out, he goes about in the earth trying to find rest. He finds none. He says, I think I'm going to go back to my house. How many of you know demons claim our bodies as their house? But when you're strong, when you walk in the power of God, you always win. You're always a victorious, overcoming one. Now notice, I gotta hurry up. We wrestle against darkness of this world, against spiritual wickedness. Or you can say wicked spirits. We wrestle against wicked spirits. What are wicked spirits? Spirits of immorality. Spirits of uncleanness. Spirits that want to get the believer, the church member, to do wicked things. Wicked spirits. What do they come to the believer and fight for? To pull us back into wicked behavior. Paul said, for this reason, you walk in God's power. You walk in God's power, the power of these demons, these principalities will be nothing. Are you all listening? So now notice chapter 1, please. Chapter 1, and look at verse 19. Notice Paul says, 1:19, and what is the exceeding greatness? The exceeding greatness of whose power? Notice God's power that you and I are commanded to walk in and operate from. Notice that power is exceedingly great power. It exceeds all other powers. What is the exceedingly great power to usward? Do y'all see that? What does that mean? That power is given to us for our benefit.
is to us. This exceedingly great power has been given to usward. It is given to us for our benefit. Why? Because there are devils who want to lock you down and take you out. But thank God, when we walk in this kind of power, this exceedingly great power, no devil can overcome, can conquer, can put me underfoot, because I walk in an exceedingly greater power. I got power over all devils. And the Bible says power is plural because there are many powers of evil, you see. Addiction is what? Perversion is what? Lying and cheating. These are all different powers. What is the exceeding greatness of his power? To us word. Now notice this phrase. What's the next two words? Say it louder than that. Say it louder than that. So this power is for who? Say it louder. Hey! Are you a believer? Are you a child of God? Then this power belongs to you. Here's what Jesus said. Listen to what Jesus said. He said, these signs shall follow those, same phrase, those who believe. In my name they shall do what? Say it louder. Believers are to have dominion over devils. And not be overcome by devils. Jesus said this should be a sign in every believer's life that they overcome, walk on, tread upon, cast out devils. Well, we have a lot of believers today who are totally defeated, you see. Because this power of God is not preached much anymore. Notice, this power is toward us who believe. According, this power is according to the working of whose mighty power? What kind of power? Mighty power is for the believer. Notice the effect or the results of this power. Look at verse 21. Because this is exceedingly great power, verse 21 says, is far above all of those principalities. See, he said in chapter 6, we got to wrestle against principalities, right? But notice the power that we have at our disposal, given to us by God for our victory, that verse says is far above all principalities. Do y'all see this? Then why would any believer walk in defeat? Well, I tell you why, because we have no understanding of this power. We don't know how to get the power. We don't know how to flow in the power. We don't know how to operate the power. So we live a defeated little religious lives hoping God to have mercy. This power, it is far above because it is exceedingly great. It is far above all principality and all what else?
Power.
All power. Every power of the devil. And might and dominion. Well, no devil should be dominating us. No devil should be more mighty than us, more powerful than us. Because we have exceeding great power. So notice, it mentions the devil power, our power. It always says we got greater. It mentions the devil's power and the power of the believer. It always lets us know we have the greater power, doesn't it? Say something louder than that. Well, hallelujah, we ought to be shouting, running around the building already. Notice 1 John chapter 2, look at verse 14. We saw this last week. Let me just go over it again quickly. 1 John chapter 2 and verse 14. 1 John chapter 2 and verse 14. 1 John chapter 2 and look at verse 14. Hallelujah.
when you and I don't learn to walk in this power that God has made available to us, you know, this is a sad reality. As many people on the world, in the world, it's on all kinds of drugs. So are people in the church. People in the world got spirits of perversion that has taken them over. Many churches got the same problem. Most marriages in the world are destroyed by the devil. Same in the church. Why? We should be greater. Notice John 2:14. The latter part of that verse says, I've written unto you, young men, because you are what? You are strong. I write to you because you are strong, and the word of God abideth in you, and you are strong, and you have overcome the who? Well, what's the idea of this verse? In order to overcome the wicked devil, the wicked one who is Satan, you have to be strong. You are strong, and you have overcome him. You don't overcome the devil being weak. No Christian walks in victory being a weak Christian. No, if you're being overcome, it's because you're weak. Don't play with it. Being religious, looking pious, is a waste of time. Be honest with yourself and say, Father, I need some power. I need some power in my life. Notice you've overcome. That word overcome means to conquer. It means to get the victory over. Strong people get the victory over the devil. Strong people conquer the devil, and they are not conquered by the devil. But notice you can be a believer. If you are not strong, you will be overcome by the devil instead of overcoming him. Are y'all in the house? Well, thank God for the almighty strength of God. Paul commanded the church, you be strong. You be strong in the Lord. Hallelujah. Well, now let's just keep moving. Luke chapter 10. We saw this one last week. We saw many last week. I'm just going to share these few, then going to move on. But notice Luke 10, please. And look at verse 17. Luke 10 and look at verse 17. And while you're looking, you can shout glory.
Glory.
Hallelujah. Glory. Glory be to the Lamb. Notice Luke 10 and look at verse 17. And the 70 returned again with joy. They came back to Jesus saying, Lord, even the devils are subject unto us. Now, when you got devils being subject to you, you're something else. See, most people are subject to devils. The devil say smoke, they do. They can't help it. It's the most horrible thing. Nicotine is the greatest killer in this country to this day. Heart disease, lung disease, everything. Nicotine. And when I see people still sucking on it, my heart breaks. They know they're sucking on death. Why do they do it? You and I know exactly why. They are slaves. You and I know exactly why. I used to be a cigarette smoker. I smoked a pack of cigarettes a day. I smoked cool cigarettes. The cool is menthol you can feel going down your throat. In a day, I was delivered. Power of God broke it. Broke it. Didn't have to wear a patch. To hope I can get free and still sweat when I see a cigarette because I'm afraid it's going to get me again. power broke it. Notice, even the devils are subject. Now, what does it mean to be subject? It means that they submit and obey. Devils? Devils? Submit and obey? They're subject unto us through thy name. Notice verse 19. Notice what Jesus says. The first thing he says is, behold. What does that mean? Take special note and don't miss this. Jesus says, behold this. Take special, let it register deep in your thinking, on your brain, and don't miss it. Behold, I give unto you what? Power. That's why devils submit. I give you power. Power. I give unto you power. Notice what this power is for. To tread upon serpents and scorpions. Now, serpents and scorpions carry venom that can hurt you, cripple you, kill you. But I give you power to walk on them, to crush them under your feet. I give you power. That's why they submit. I gave you power to walk on them. Get them under your feet. I give you power to tread on, to walk on serpents. Of course, these are demons. Serpents and scorpions. And I give you power over how much? All the power of who? Notice Jesus acknowledged Satan has power. But I give you power over all his power. All his power. There is no power of the devil that you don't have greater power over. He said, I give you this power. And what I like, he's talking to 70. Not, well, that's the 12 apostles. You know, they had special stuff. No, we read in Ephesians, this is for those who believe. This power is for the brethren. It's for the brethren. Just because we don't operate in it, just because we don't acknowledge it, doesn't mean God hadn't given it to us. We just rather placate our weaknesses with a doctrine called grace. Let's just stay defeated and just thank God, grace. We have power to walk in victory. Now notice, I give unto you power of all the power of the enemy. Thank God. That nothing shall by any means hurt you. No devil should be plaguing your life. No devil should be plaguing my life. Are you all listening? Not if I learn to walk in this power. And notice very clearly from the verses we've read, it's not God withholding it. It's we not understanding how to receive it and operate in it. We'll talk about that some other weeks. But right now we're seeing that we got a greater power. And you don't overcome demonic spirits without greater power than they. We must be stronger than devils. Somebody say something. Amen. Amen. Now Revelation, please, chapter 12. Oh, Jesus. Revelation chapter 12, and look at verse 7. We're going to have to pick up the pace a little bit here. Revelation chapter 12, and look at verse 7, please. Hallelujah. Well, glory to God. Ah, somebody hold my mule. I feel a shout coming on. Glory to God. And there was war in heaven. Well, now Paul said, we got a war against these spirits, you see. But before we had to fight them, heaven had to fight them. Notice verse 7, and there was, not there is, there was war in heaven. Michael and his angels fought. Well, that's what you do when you're in a battle, you fight. Are you all listening? I said, that's what you do when you're, you know why so many Christians are so pathetically defeated? They never fight. We just whimper and cry and don't fight. Fight if you want victory. Fight if you want freedom. Fight. Fight and fight to win. Now notice, there was war in heaven. The archangel Michael and his angels fought against the dragon. Well, how many of you know Paul said we fight not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against... See, we these things are against us. And Paul said we got to fight them. Notice, fought against the dragon, and the dragon fought and his angels. Well, look at verse 9. And the great dragon was cast out. Cast out. Verse 7 says that there was war in heaven. So when he was cast out of where? And the great dragon was cast out of heaven, that old serpent. Well, how many of you know Jesus? We just read Jesus says, I give you power over serpents. So this old serpent shouldn't be dominating you. His name is the devil. His name is Satan. He has power. If he had no power, the archangel wouldn't have had to fight him to get him out. The great dragon was cast out, that old serpent called the devil and Satan. That's who he is. Who deceiveth the whole earth, a world. He was cast out where? Notice he was cast out of heaven to the earth. Where do you live? Well, that's where he's at. He was cast out of heaven into the earth, and his demonic fallen angels were cast out with him. So notice now we got a fight. It's not a fight against flesh and blood, but it's a fight against Satan and his demonic princes, you see. Well, now it would be very unfair if God sent these spiritual beings down to earth and left us ill-equipped to fight them and win. We would have an excuse why we are defeated. Like so many Christians think they have, you know, an excuse. There is no excuse. This old nasty, slimy serpent called the devil. He was cast out of heaven into the earth. But now look at the next verse. This is where it gets good. Notice and is a conjunctive word. You can't properly understand verse 10 without verse 9. Because the word and joins verse 9 to verse 10, doesn't it? Notice, and I heard a loud voice, a shouting voice, saying from heaven. Where was the devil cast out from? To where?
Earth.
When he came to earth, a voice came from heaven, a loud voice. Notice what that loud voice said. Now, you know who voice this is? It's the voice of God saying, hey, I cast the devil down to you, but let me tell you, I give you my strength, I give you my power, and by my power, I want you to kick his butt. You know what your Bible says about Satan, about Jesus? It says that Jesus is sitting on the right hand of God the Father, waiting
till every enemy be brought underfoot. He's not lifting a finger. He's seated waiting. He knows he's given us what it takes to whip every devil. Now notice what this verse says. A loud voice from heaven saying, now is come. Now is a very strong word that identifies a point in time. At what point of time is this now? When Satan came to earth. Now is come. When Satan came to earth, now has come to earth. Notice, now is come. Number one, what? People, if you got to read your Bible, let's just go home. Now it's come what? Open your mouth.
Salvation.
And I'm going to show you what the word salvation means. It literally means deliverance, protection, rescue. Yes. The word salvation means, literally, it means deliverance, protection, rescue. When Satan came to earth, now, God shouts from heaven, earthlings, earth people, now has come to you deliverance, protection, rescue. Four things has come since Satan has come. What's the next thing?
Strength.
Say it louder.
Strength.
Now has come. It didn't come until Satan showed up. But now has come. The only way to overcome Satan, we have to be stronger. But now has come the strength of heaven. But now has come strength. What's the third thing that has come? Read it. Now, I'm going to show you this. Paul said this. The kingdom of God is not in word, but it's in what? So when the kingdom of God comes, that means power. The kingdom of God doesn't come in words. The Bible said it comes in power. So why has the kingdom of God come now? Because there's a devil that we have to fight. But now has come the kingdom of power, the kingdom of might, deliverance, protection, rescue, the strength of Almighty God. What else has come? Read it. Read it louder than that. Notice the power of Christ. Why do we get strength and power? Same thing Paul said, walk in. Because you got to fight against principalities and powers. He said, I command you, walk in the strength and the power of Almighty God. Notice it's already been given because the devil has shown up. We can't lick the devil except we are stronger and have more power. Are y'all here?
Amen.
This is wonderful. I need not be defeated. Let me hurry up. Now has come rescue, strength, the kingdom of our God, and the power of Christ. And this is why these things have come for, because the accuser of the brethren is what? Because Satan has been cast from heaven down to the earth, and because he's been cast down to you, I announce to you, I give you my power. It's an unbelievable. How do you say it? What are we to do when we know there's a devil and we feel so helpless? God, do something. He's given you might. He's given you deliverance. We have this because Satan has come. Read verse 11 on three. Read it loud. Lift up your voices. One, two, three, read. Read it again. Read it again. Oh,
by the might, by the power, by the strength of Almighty God, I overcome devils. We overcome them.
Not without God's strength. Not without God's might. Are you all listening to me? Do you all see this? It's in your Bible for an unmistakable purpose. To let you and I know we don't have to be defeated and we don't have to be afraid of any bondage ever. Now, for time's sake, let me show you what the word salvation means. This is one of the things God has given us that we might overcome the devil. He gave us salvation, right? Yeah. What did I say salvation meant? Read it. Tell me. Deliverance, protection, rescue. Notice, please, Luke chapter 1 and verse 67 or 69. Luke 1 and verse 69. Hallelujah. Glory to God. We have the power of his Christ. How many of you, listen, you know this, no devil could stand before Christ. He cast out devils all the time. No devil could stand before Christ because of the power he walked in. Your Bible says the power of Christ has come to us. Notice what it says, please. Luke 1, 69. Notice, and has raised up an horn of salvation. For who? Now notice, in your Bible, horn always speaks of power. We could say he's raised up the power of salvation. Horn always speaks of power. In the animal kingdom, the animal with the greatest, largest horns rules. Horns speaks of power. They flaunt their horns to let you know I'm more powerful than you. And a horn always speaks of power. Now notice, he's given to us, God has raised up for us, and horn of salvation. Or you can say the power of salvation. There's no salvation without power. There's no rescue without power. There's no deliverance without power. There's no protection without power. Look at verse 7 and 1. Why has he given us this salvation? 7 and 1. That, for this reason. That we. He gave it to us, right? That we should be saved, delivered, rescued from who? That's why salvation came when Satan came. That we might be saved or rescued from our enemies. Notice, and from the hand of all that hate us. How many of you know every demon hates your guts? But they can't touch a person who walks in this power. See, this power protects us from all of his attacks. Notice, we have a horn of salvation, power of salvation, that we might be saved, same word, salvation is the same Greek word, meaning delivered, rescued, protected, that we might be delivered from our enemies and from all the demons that hate us. Notice verse 74. Here's another reason why this salvation has come. That God would grant unto us that we, being, read it loud, delivered out of the hand of our enemies. Salvation means to be delivered out of the hand of your enemies. Now has come salvation. What is salvation? Deliverance from your enemies. Why did he send salvation when Satan came? Now has come the first thing. Salvation, what is that? Deliverance from your enemies. Are you all here?
Yes.
When did this come? When Satan showed up. Is Satan still here?
Yes.
Then his salvation, his strength, his power, his kingdom is still here for you to overcome devils. Hallelujah. That verse says that we should, being delivered out of the hands of our enemies, might serve God without fear of bondage, of defeat, never again, because of the power of salvation. I have no fear of bondage, of addictions, of worry, of depression, ever again. It's been broken. It's been what?
Broken.
Notice, if you will, peace. 1 Corinthians chapter 4. I'm wrapping this thing up. The Bible also says, now has come the kingdom of our God, right? Well, when did the kingdom of our God come? The Bible says that now it has come because Satan has come. Well, what's the kingdom of the kingdom of our God? 1 Corinthians chapter 4, and look at verse 20. This is what the kingdom of our God looks like. Notice verse 20. I want you to read it loud. I want you to lift up your voice. I want you to strain your voice like I'm doing. Come on, let's let every devil in hell hear. We believe the word of God. Read it on three. One, two, three, read. Notice, the kingdom of God is not cheap talk. That's religion. That's sad, stale religion. There's no religion that can bring true deliverance. Not Islam, not the Catholic Church, not the Mormon Church, not the Jehovah's Witness Church, because they have no power. The true church operates from the kingdom of God. And notice, the kingdom of God is in,
power.
Say it louder.
Power.
Now listen, when Satan came to earth, God shouted from heaven to earth, now is come the kingdom of God. What is the kingdom of God?
Power.
Say it louder.
Power.
The kingdom of power, the power of the kingdom of heaven has come to earth because of the devil. And this is how the Bible says, and we overcome him. By the strength of God, by the power of God, by the deliverance, by the protection, by the rescue of Almighty God. I got to quit. I ain't gonna quit. Matthew 12. Matthew 12. Let me just show you a couple of more really quick. Matthew 12. And look at verse 28. Matthew 12. And look at verse 28. And when you know these, it breaks your heart to see how many Christians are so defeated. And they gloss over their weakness with the doctrine of grace. So many Christian women, big profiled Christian women, dress so lewd. They're possessed by a spirit of lewdness. And their greatest teaching is grace. How many preachers are possessed with spirits of whoredom? And they explain it away with the doctrine of grace. What do you mean by grace? Jesus forgives us no matter what. We're all going to heaven, so it don't matter. Jesus got the victory for us, so we don't have to fool with it. It's a lie from hell. You are to have your own victory. Notice, verse 28, Matthew 12. Notice Jesus says, but if I cast out devils, if I cast out devils by what? Or you could say by the power of God. Jesus says you shall receive power after the Holy Ghost comes. He says, wait for the promise of the Father. Be speaking of the Holy Spirit. You shall be endued with power. The Holy Ghost is the Spirit of power. Many verses say that. The Holy Ghost is the Spirit of power. We have not received the spirit of fear, but the spirit of what?
Power.
The Holy Ghost is the Spirit of power. Now notice. But if I cast out devils by the power of the Holy Spirit, then the kingdom of God is what? Now notice, look. Revelation says, now is come the kingdom. This verse says, know that the kingdom has come. How do you know that the kingdom has come? Because there's power to break devils. Because there's power to do what? The kingdom of God is coming Friday night. The kingdom of God, Jesus says, you know it has come. Because you see devils screaming out and running. The power of God is a sign for you to know God's kingdom. It's here. The kingdom of God has come. Devils are fleeing. When a church is without that, that church is without power. This was totally normal in Jesus' ministry. And your Bible says we now have the power of Christ. Doesn't it?
Yes.
For one reason, because of devils. Notice Luke 4, please, and verse 14. Luke 4 and verse 14. Okay, I don't have time to read that. Just go to Luke 11. I'm gonna stop on this one. Luke 11. Don't miss this. Don't miss what I'm about to read. Luke 11 and look at verse 20. We're stopping on this one. Do not miss what I'm about to read. Are you all ready?
Yes.
Man, I should have read the other one I wanted to read. Okay, somebody say I got time. Go back to Luke 4. Don't blame me now. Blame these people who pretend that they love the word. Look at Luke 4, please. And look at verse 14. Verse 14. And Jesus returned in the power. Jesus returned in the power of what?
Spirit.
Remember, Jesus says, I cast out demons by the Spirit of God. Meaning he cast out demons by the power of the Spirit, you see. Jesus returned in the power of the Spirit. I want you to see where he returned to, into Galilee. So Jesus went into Galilee with power, right? He went with what?
Power.
Look at verse 31 now. And Jesus came down to Capernaum, a city of what?
Galilee.
What did Jesus have in Galilee?
Power.
Notice he's in Galilee now with what?
Power.
With power. Look at verse 33. And in the synagogue there was a man who had, now notice what this man had, a spirit of an unclean devil. Notice he didn't have a spirit of infirmity, a spirit of sickness, a spirit of disease. He had a spirit of what? What kind of spirit is an unclean spirit? An immoral spirit. Jesus cast out more unclean spirits than he did any other kind. Because there's a lot of healthy people with spirits of filth in them. Unclean spirits. Notice Jesus cast out an unclean or an immoral spirit.
Look at verse 31. And what did the Spirit do? And read it, please. And cried out with what? Now, this is always how unclean spirits come out. This is how we know that young people were getting delivered from lust and perversion and pornography Friday night, because a lot of them were crying out. See, that's what spirits do when they are intimidated by greater power. Jesus went into Capernaum with what?
Power.
Into Galilee with what?
Power.
And he met an unclean spirit in church. A spirit of perversion in church. An immoral spirit in church. And what did that spirit begin to do? A lot of spirits were crying out here Friday night at the altar. Because they had to come out. Because the kingdom had come. Notice, please. They were crying. This spirit was crying out with a loud voice. Look at verse 35. And Jesus rebuked the devil, saying, "Hold your peace, shut up, and come out." And when the devil, notice, had thrown him down in the midst, he came out, but he didn't hurt them. See, when people begin to manifest like this, you think it looks like they're being hurt. They squirm around like little snakes. They cry out. They fall out on the ground and start jiving. It looked like they, but they never get hurt. It's a demon manifesting. Notice what these devils did. Number one, they were crying out. Number two, they fell out on the ground. They're demons. Just to make a point, and I wanted to go back to this, because this is exactly what happened Friday. At the altar, young people were falling out, crying out on the ground with loud voices. These are always manifestations of immoral spirits coming out of them. Notice what happens. Verse 36, and they were all amazed. That's always the first response when people see this. They were all amazed and spoke among themselves, saying, "What a word is this? For with authority and power, Jesus commands the unclean spirits," and they do what? Immoral spirits, perversion spirits, addiction spirits, lust spirits. Many young people are gripped with these spirits, many. And in most cases, churches have no answers. So they let them come lewd, half-dressed, looking like they just come from who knows where. But at least they're in the church singing. Not in the true church. Are you all listening to me? Now let's go to the one I was going to read, then I'm out of here. Notice 11, please, and verse 20. Always these spirits cry out. I'm not going to have time, but Matthew chapter 16, the Bible says Jesus gave his disciples power over unclean spirits. We must have power over immorality. And you know what pulls people into that? Your Bible says rulers of the darkness of this world, spiritual wicked, they're demons. Thank God there's a greater power. We're going to read this one, then I'm going to stop. Luke 11, please, and look at verse 20. This is the last one, so focus intently. You've been asleep? Wake up now. Don't miss this one. Look at verse 20. But God said unto him. Nope, I'm at the wrong verse. All right, now verse 20. Notice Jesus says, but if I, with the finger, the power of God, if I, by God's power, cast out devils, then there's no doubt the kingdom of God is what? Remember Revelation. Now has come the kingdom of our God. How do you know it's come? It's no doubt when you see the kingdom of God present, demons run. Now notice this. The next verse.
He explains what happens when you cast out devils, when you take dominion over devils and don't have them dominate you. Notice he says, when a strong man, notice he calls Satan a strong man. Listen, we all, if you are age 6 or older, you know demons are strong. They are strong enough to drive a person to do all kinds of horrible things. They are very strong. Notice, Jesus is explaining something. Don't miss it. Number one, he calls Satan a strong man. When a strong man, armed, he keepeth. When he's strong, when he's armed, he's able to keep. Keepeth his palace. His goods are in what?
Peace.
Well, you know when Satan, when there's no more peace, when a stronger power comes, he starts screaming. But notice he said, now look, and he keepeth, and he keepeth his goods. Listen, this strong man in this parable is Satan, isn't it? Listen to me carefully. How does Satan get any goods? Jesus called him a thief and a robber. Any good Satan got is yours. You let him steal them. You let him take them. How does Satan get anything? But he takes it from you. He steals. He's a robber. But now they're mine. And I protect what I have taken. You will never get it back, he says. But notice what Jesus says. But when a stronger than he comes, you have to be stronger than him. This is so profound. When a stronger than the devil comes, we're able to take back what he's stolen. You can only take back what the devil has taken is if you become stronger than he. Do you see this? We didn't make this up. It's in your, Jesus is explaining. How do you get devils to bow to you? You have to be stronger. Notice he says, and when a stronger than the devil shall come upon him. When you're stronger, you do what and what? Read it louder. You only overcome the devil if you're stronger than the devil. You only overcome the devil if you're stronger than the devil. We must refuse to be weak Christians. We must make up our mind we're not going to be mancy, pantsy, sissified Christians. And don't tell me I'm a man. You are defeated. You're weak. This isn't flesh and blood. Paul says it this way. The weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but they are mighty through God. To the pulling down of what? Only a strong man can have a stronghold. But we have more mighty weapons. See, all this is the Bible to talk to us. It's not about simple religion. Religion is cheap as dirt. We are to have power. Okay, let me read this one. I'm tired now. Verse 22. But when a stronger than the devil shall come upon him, the stronger one is able to overcome the devil. John said, you young men, you are strong and you overcome the wicked one. You only overcome him because you're stronger. Notice, when you're able to overcome the devil, what's the next part? Read it. Taketh from him his armor and his goods. In other words, we're able to take back whatever he's stolen from us. My sanity is gone. I'm on 5 tranquilizers. I worry all the time. You can take your sanity back. Yeah.
on and on and on and on. Satan has stolen a lot. Anything he has, Jesus called it his goods and his spoils. Any stuff Satan has, he's taking it from us. And we shouldn't be content to sit back and let him have it. And looking nice. Looking nice don't mean 2 cents worth of nothing. Learn to look ugly. Learn to get nasty. Learn to get down dirty. Learn to have a good scrap and win. Can I be frank? The worst Christians are the ones who look beautifully well, serene, and tranquil. Their problem is they have absolutely no fight. So they put on an exterior of piety, but they have no fight. We need fighters. Not against flesh and blood, but fighters against principalities and powers and the rulers of the darkness and wicked spirits. Stand, 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 stand. Hallelujah. Jesus says, I'm able to cast out devils because I'm stronger. And when I cast out a devil, I can take back what he has stolen. Come on, somebody shout glory.
Glory.
Give Jesus a hand. Give Jesus a hand clap. Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Lord.
Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Jesus.
Worship the King.
Hallelujah.
Worship the King.
Thank you, Jesus.
Worship the King.
Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord.
Worship the King.
Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus.
I refuse to have my house ransacked by devils and my goods stolen.